Hi, I'm Ken Trimber, and welcome to the KTA University Podcast. The podcasts are designed to tackle relevant subjects to fabrication, construction, cleaning, and painting, both industrial and commercial. The subject of this podcast is painted bolted connections. We're going to talk about the laboratory testing and certification process and some things you may be concerned with in the field when you're painting bolted connections. My guest tonight is Carly McGee. Carly's the manager of KTA's physical testing laboratory where the bolted connection testing is being performed. And Carly is a member of the RCSC Standards Committee. That's the Research Council on Structural Connections, where all this work is done, where the standards are developed. So Carly, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you.
We'll start right in. I know that all bolted connections don't have to be painted, but we're talking about just painted ones for the purpose of this podcast. So when they're painted and they're slip critical, what attributes of the coatings are you really testing for?
They're evaluated for slip coefficient and tension creep deformation. Tension creep deformation is sometimes also called compression creep.
Okay, and what does all that mean, or why is that important?
Slip critical joints are designed to prevent slip and for the limit states of bearing type connections. So a class A coating would exhibit a minimum slip coefficient of 0.30 or greater, and a class B coating would exhibit a slip coefficient of 0.50 or greater.
Okay, so what does the test method evaluate?
The test method evaluates the suitability of a coating for a slip critical joint and determines the mean slip coefficient that will be used in the design of the joint. It also evaluates the tension creep deformation so that the compression due to the clamping force of the bolt allows the coating to provide acceptable performance.
So they need a certain friction, I guess, in the joint of the coatings in the joint. When they design it, it might help to decide how many bolts to install on a splice plate or something like that.
Sure.
This helps determine that.
Absolutely.
Interesting. I mentioned RCSC in the introduction. Who are they and why are they relevant?
The RCSC, the Research Council on Structural Connections, promotes investigations to support evaluation of the strength and behavior of various types of structural connections and promotes the knowledge of efficient practices. They also publish and create the specifications that are related to such.
Okay, so they're the body that governs all the work and sets the criteria for the classifications. You had mentioned before a class A and a class B. I believe class A was 0.30 and class B is 0.50 slip coefficient. Are there any other classes?
ASHTO also recognizes a class C for hot dip galvanized surfaces. That's in the ASHTO LRFD bridge design specification. And hot dip galvanizing is no longer required to be roughened.
Okay, so class C would be what, smooth hot dip galvanizing?
Yes, it doesn't require any abrasive blast cleaning or roughening.
Now, if I did roughen it, I assume I'd get a higher class because C would be lower than the other two.
Roughened hot dip galvanizing is classified as class A under RCSC.
Okay. So it's interesting. So the classifications are really, the order is A, C, B, even though the letters aren't in that order in terms of friction.
It's true. The class A and class C are both a minimum of 0.30.
They're both about the same. Okay. I'm going to ask you to briefly explain the testing equipment and the procedure, but first, can you tell me a little bit about the test panels themselves that you prepare for testing?
Sure. The test panels are fabricated from 5/8-inch thick steel plate with a minimum specified yield strength. They are drilled with 1-inch holes, and we use 7/8-inch bolts, so there's enough clearance between the bolt and the hole to ensure adequate space for a slip.
So if it slips, you don't want the bolt to go into bearing, I gather, is why
Correct.
The hole is a little bit larger.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What about the thickness of the coating, things like that?
The thickness of the coating is applied at 2 mils greater than the certification thickness. That's to allow for the occasional buildup of overspray or other occurrences and to ensure that the coating is going to provide satisfactory performance.
So if I get a certification that the coating is good to 5 mils. You're saying you actually tested it to 7 mils.
Correct.
But the cert is only 5.
That's right.
Okay. And the panels have to be perfectly flat, is my understanding.
As flat as possible is always best.
And do you typically use hot rolled or cold rolled, or does it matter?
We use cold rolled steel because hot rolled steel typically has an inherent profile to the surface. So cold rolled, we get much flatter beginning surface, and then we abrasive blast clean them from there.
Oh, okay. And then as far as the application conditions, I assume this is all very tightly controlled mm-hmm. with humidity and so forth?
It is. The cure time and the cure conditions are essential variables, and those will be listed on the certificate. The connections cannot be assembled until the minimum cure time on the certificate is met.
Okay. All right. Now, can you explain the process? We have the panels prepared. What is the testing process? And I think we have a few photos that we'll be referring to here.
Sure. For the slip coefficient test, static clamping force is specified, and that remains constant throughout the test. And then a compressive load is applied to the middle plate. There are a series of 3 plates that are sandwiched together by that compressive force, and the load is applied to the middle plate, and then we measure the deformation of the middle plate with respect to the 2 outer plates.
Okay, and that's for the coefficient of friction testing.
That's for the short-term slip coefficient test.
Slip coefficient mm-hmm. test. So if it fails that, I guess you're done.
It is. The slip coefficient test result will determine the load that's placed on the tension creep specimens. The tension creep test is a 6-week test. The deformation of the middle plate with respect to the outer two is measured for a period of 1,000 hours or 42 days.
Okay, so I understand on the first for the coefficient of friction or slip coefficient test, you're putting a load on the middle plate to try to make it slip. How does it work for the tension creep? What does that apparatus look like?
The tension creep test, we put 3 series of specimens in a chain-like arrangement, and a load in tension is applied to the entire chain. The individual specimens themselves are assembled with A490 bolts, and those coatings are subject to compression from the clamping force that's applied by that bolt. So the clamping force is not static as it is in with the slip coefficient test. It's actually reduced over time, and you have the additional joint shear that's applied.
So what is the clamping force for these tests? What's it based on?
It's based on the minimum clamping force for an A490 bolt, which is 49 kips.
Okay. All right. So how long does the process take? I understand you said that the one test was about 6 weeks, mm-hmm. the tension creep. How long is the coefficient of friction testing? How long does that test take?
Each of the replicate tests take about 7 minutes each. All in all, the entire process takes about 8 weeks plus cure time from assembly of the specimens, the fabrication, the coating application, and the testing itself.
Okay. You mentioned before the interview that there are some changes to Appendix A under development. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. As in with any specification, there are constantly changes being proposed that deal with better defining some of the variables, improving the accuracy of the measurement techniques, and improving the figures that are contained in the specification as well.
Any idea when that might be published?
We hope that it's published very soon.
Soon. Okay, so sometime during 2018 is the hope.
Potentially, yes.
Okay, great. Back to the materials. Can you give me some examples of some coatings or materials that meet Class A and Class B?
Sure. Class B coatings usually include inorganic zinc-rich primers, some organic zinc-rich primers, and also bare abrasive blast clean steel. Class A coatings, as you mentioned, hot dip galvanizing that's roughened, meets a minimum of a 0.30 for Class A qualification. Most organic zinc-rich primers also meet Class A.
Okay. And what about thermal spray coatings?
Most thermal spray coatings exhibit Class B behavior. However, once they're sealed, the presence of any sealant usually prohibits the thermal spray from meeting Class B.
All right, so if I'm doing thermal spray on a bridge, I should leave the joints bare after the metallizing, don't do anything to them, and but then seal and paint the rest of the bridge.
Correct.
So certifications are issued upon completion of testing. Can you tell me what information is included on the cert?
The certificate will include the batch number of the coating material, the name of the coating material, the cure time, the cure conditions, and also the thinner that was used, as well as the dry film thickness.
All right, so in the field, they have to maintain that before, or in the shop when they do the work, before they button up a connection. They have to make sure they comply with all of that.
Correct.
So conceivably, I could have a different thickness in the joint than I do on the rest of the structure.
Sure. The coating is certified at the manufacturer's recommended maximum thickness, typically, but the coating on the faying surfaces cannot exceed that that's listed on the certificate.
Okay. But a manufacturer might have a suggested range on the PDS, but I know in some cases they'll say, oh, sorry, you can go a little bit heavier for the and the three-coat system, for example. But what I think I'm hearing is in the case of the joint, while they might allow a heavier thickness elsewhere, they cannot exceed what's on that cert.
Right. The certification thickness is very specific.
Okay. All right. And how long must the primer cure before assembling the joint?
For the minimum amount of time that's listed on the certificate, it can cure longer, but if you were to assemble the joint after a shorter period of time, all curing of that coating could cease in the joint. In fact, the coating could act as a lubricant.
Okay, and what are some, is, and this may be not a fair question, but general curing times, minimum curing times, is there any kind of rule from what you've seen or range?
Most inorganic zincs are about 24 hours. Organic zincs could range from 3 or 4 days up to a week.
Oh, is that right? Before connecting. So the inorganic zinc is quicker.
Absolutely.
Well, let's say that I did assemble a joint too soon. Say the certification said 24 hours and we did it in 18 hours. And we realize it. Can we take that joint apart? Let it cure and then kind of reassemble it?
Unfortunately, no. Assembly of the joint will damage the coating.
Okay, so you can't do that. So what would you do? Just start over or I guess retest a shorter?
You could retest the coating at a shorter cure interval. However, at that point, you would probably need to abrasive blast clean and recoat.
All right, let's assume I've got two different products that both have Class B certifications. And I have one on the steel and a different one on the splice plates.
Okay.
When I put those together, will they still be a, can I be assured that's still a Class B?
Mixing of different faying surfaces, there are different opinions on the subject. The specification, by definition, states that a Class B surface is a Class B surface regardless of which coating is applied to that faying surface. The engineer of record should be consulted on the subject, and the EOR might require testing to prove the suitability of the system.
I mean, that would make sense to me that you want to make sure that you're, the two you're mating together have truly been tested.
It's true. There's no research on the subject that's readily available.
Okay. And I know the you mentioned earlier the panels are prepared by abrasive blast cleaning. Now, sometimes in the field, they don't want to, if they're doing a small addition to a bridge, they don't want to bring out a blast nozzle. Mm-hmm. They might do power tool cleaning to SP11, let's just say. Would I have to, would that be certified or do I have to test it if I'm going to use SP11?
By definition, a Class B surface and a Class A surface would be abrasive blast cleaned. If you wanted to power tool clean a surface, you should definitely check with the engineer of record, and they're probably going to require testing.
Testing of it. Okay. What about the full system? There have been some interest in applying all coats on in the shop rather than just the zinc primer. So when they get into the field, maybe use galvanized fasteners, and there's very little touch-up. You don't have all the splice plates to repair, for example. What about that? Can we put all three coats on the back rather than just the zinc?
Very thick coatings and multi-coat systems are subject to compression of the coating system due to the clamping force of the bolt. So a loss of pretension in that joint is a reality. The specification states that coatings up to 17 mils thick do exhibit less compression than those that are beyond that thickness. However, that's something else that you may want to consider having tested if the loss of pretension is a concern.
I think we pretty much covered. Any closing comments you'd like to make?
No, thank you, Ken.
Okay. Well, let me do a little summary here. The testing standard is developed by the Research Council on Structural Connections, the RCSC, and you have specially designed panels. Very flat panels are prepared, glass cleaned, painted under very exacting parameters, all of which are recorded on the certificate to make sure that in the field you are complying with those same conditions. If the samples pass tension or slip coefficient testing, which is about less than 10 minutes per test per replicate, if it passes that, you can then move to the tension creep, which is about a 42-day test. You need to do both to get the certification. The certificate is either a Class A or Class B. There are some Class Cs, but for the purpose of our discussion on paints, Class A or Class B. Class A is 0.30, Class B is 0.50 coefficient of friction. And again, once the certificate is issued, you've got to monitor your work in the field to make sure you comply with the thickness, the curing time before bolting. If you're mating two different Class B surfaces together, they may very well qualify as a Class B, but to be safe, it's best to test that so you have data showing that those two different products together still retain their Class B certification. The standard requires the samples be blast clean. So if you're going to use power tool cleaning in the field, power tool cleaning should be tested under that coating system to be safe. And again, the engineer of record could make an interpretation on some of these and perhaps not require the testing, but it would be probably wise to do the testing just to be sure. As far as the coatings on the backside of the plates, the tests are all done with zinc, the same product on both sides, and it doesn't have to be zinc, it might be metallizing, maybe a different product, but it's the same product on both sides without the additional coats. If you're going to apply additional coats, it would be beneath the bolt head and the washer nut. Again, check with the EOR, but because of the loss of pretension or potential loss of pretension, it'd be a good idea to test that. So that's it. Thanks for tuning in, and please join us again for our next KTA University Podcast.